Okay, Owen, you want to take it away?
Sure.
All right. Everyone click on speaker view and we'll get this party started.
Welcome back to our virtual nave. We miss it. You know, it's a noisy place. It's not a perfect building, but we miss it enough that we wanted to recreate it for you. At some point, we're going to try to make this a playable space for over the summer. So we'll share that with you at some point. So our first speaker is Helen-Maria Nugent. She's our Dean of Design. She's a really special person. She's come to us from the Chicago Art Institute, and she's been here, I want to say 3 years now. She's the head of the largest division at CCA, which is the design division. And under her leadership, she's brought lots of new energy. And we want to really acknowledge her support for the illustration program. So without further ado, let's bring on Helen-Maria Nugent.
Hi, everyone. Wow. Okay, that was just unbelievably splendid. I feel feels very ceremonial. Thank you for crafting that for us. So thanks, Owen and Michael, for inviting me to be the first speaker tonight. I'm really honored to do that. The night before graduation is actually normally a pretty sleepless night for me in the last couple of years, in that I'm pretty much up all night practicing pronouncing your names. It's a very scary thing to do. And so I'm usually really trying to I'm trying to work hard to make sure I get them right. And tonight, I'm really glad I don't have to do that, actually. Even though things are obviously really different today than they were this time last year, one thing I'm a little bummed out about, actually, is missing all of the sartorial choices, all of the looks that come together for graduation, and especially the top-notch shoe game. There's usually a lot of kind of shoe action happening as they peek out underneath your gowns. Well, nevertheless, I'm really delighted to see all of the smiling faces. I see a lot of parents, I think, too, and friends and family. That's really awesome. And distancing doesn't take away from the significance of this moment for any of us. And it's truly an unforgettable one. We're never going to forget this particular way of graduating, especially with the Minecraft. So what does it mean to graduate into this new world right now as an illustrator, a designer, and an artist? Well, I want you to just for a minute help me out with something. I want you to try and picture in your mind the image of the COVID-19 virus. Can you picture it? Right, I'm sure you've all seen it. It's that gray sphere with the spiky red tufts on the outside, right? You've seen it all over the news and in the newspapers and magazines. Well, that image was created by Alyssa Eckhart and Dan Higgins. And they are two of eight illustrators that work for the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. They've actually worked together for 14 years, and they primarily focus on these kinds of things and have made the images that we know of for Ebola, for anthrax, for antibiotic resistance, and now for COVID-19. So this somewhat overused adage that a picture is worth a thousand words, I think it's really prescient at this moment. Alyssa and Dan's illustration, it gives us concrete form to something that is otherwise completely invisible, or something that's just not visually memorable or compelling normally. Illustration has the power to communicate across dialects, across cultures, has the capacity to capture the essence of emotions and ideas, and to tell complex stories, and mostly has the capacity to bring us together in moments of sadness, in moments of wonder, and in moments of joy. So tonight, a little bit later on, we're all going to toast to the hard work, the ambition, the talent, the resilience, and the ongoing curiosity of the illustration graduates. And we're going to congratulate them on their newly minted and bona fide credentials from CCA, your BFAs. And let's not forget the sacrifices that your loved ones, that are, I can see, have made to support you in advancing your mind, your heart, and most importantly, your hands through your education here at CCA. Like your loved ones, us at CCA, including myself, we're going to follow your journeys as alumni, as you carve a unique pathway that will undoubtedly lead us into a better society and a better future. And we're going to be proud of your achievements, not just in this moment, but ongoing into the future. And you are the future. And you kind of got to get started right away. Like, we kind of need you right now to really help us in this moment. Maybe you can take the weekend off, maybe just a little bit. And as they say in Scotland, you should not be shy about tooting your own horn. We want to hear about your successes. We want to hear about what you're doing. We want to hear about what you're up to. So please don't be strangers. And we are really excited to have you as part of our CCA alumni. So the last thing I want to say is I want to thank you all for choosing CCA. We are so grateful to all of you for your belief in us. And we believe in you. And thank you so much. congratulations. I'm really excited that you're out there in the world doing your thing.
Thank you, Helen-Maria. Well, I guess it's my turn to speak. Well, this feels like a crappy time to graduate. You're ready to go out and establish a career, and the world grinds to a screeching halt. You're not a healthcare worker. You're probably not working on the front lines to keep the basics moving. You're not considered an essential worker. Let me tell you, your work is absolutely essential. When we look back at the history of past tough times, wars, pandemics, times of social injustice, we can read the history. We can see the terrible facts. But it's the artists who step up and put a human take on things and express the emotions of their time. I'd like to share my screen. And it's my chance to give you one last art history lesson, so bear with me. So let's talk about art in a time of crisis and what artists can do. One of the things we do well is we express anger, fear, and horror. Guernica was painted by Pablo Picasso in response to the bombing of a Basque country town in northern Spain by Nazi Germany and fascist Italy at the request of the Spanish nationalists. Because it so effectively communicated the horrors of war, it is regarded by many art critics as one of the most moving and powerful anti-war paintings in history. Jacob Epstein initially created the rock drill as part of a ready-made sculpture to celebrate the modern machine. By 1940, however, recalling the horrors of the 1914 to 1918 First World War, Epstein reinterpreted his own work as a statement about the mechanism of killing and the lack of humanity during wartime. David Wernajowicz's History Keeps Me Awake at Night contrasts images of greed and violence he saw in American society against a placid sleeping man. It reflects the anxiety the artist felt during the height of the AIDS crisis. Another thing that artists have done for thousands of years is we honor the dead. Sculptor Reinhard Hoff created the bronze sacrifice for the Anzac War Memorial in Sydney, Australia in the 1930s. It uses classical elements designed in an Art Deco style. Unlike earlier war memorials that emphasized the heroism of warriors, this installation embodies the tragedy of wasted potential. Other artists choose not to concentrate on a generalized collective grief, but on telling personal stories. The AIDS quilt is a project created by artists and non-artists to celebrate the unique lives of individuals lost. Another thing that artists do is we expose evil and hypocrisy. German artist George Grosz painted this during the turbulent times between World War I and before the rise of fascism. He depicts the grotesque politicians, generals, and financiers conspiring at a conference table. Grosz eventually had to flee Germany and headed to the United States, where he continued to paint and to illustrate. Dictators have long understood the power of art. They ban art that is critical to them and enlist artists to create propaganda that glorifies their regimes. Or editorial illustrators and political cartoonists create memorable images that often use symbolism and exaggeration to sway public opinion. Here, Brian Stafford's brilliant New Yorker cover is a bold example of the visual metaphor. Brian has also taught at CCA. Another thing that artists are expert at is expressing the personal. Kate Kollowitz emerged into an art world dominated by men, yet created work that centered on women and the working class. She lost her son tragically during World War I, and many of her lithographs, etchings, and woodcuts depict mourning figures, often as self-portraits. Frida Kahlo also worked in self-portraiture. As a young woman, she was struck down by a bus and suffered physically and psychologically the rest of her life. She combined images of pre-Columbian and Mexican folk traditions symbolically in her expressive self-portraits. Her work is both political and personal. Another thing that artists can do is inform, motivate, and empower. This image was created during the Great Depression of the 1930s. And it used bold shapes and dramatic scale to depict the struggles of working class and the unemployed who found strength in collective bargaining. Ben Shahn depicts French workers being turned over to the invading Germans to serve the Nazi regime during World War II. Shahn was a Jewish American artist and illustrator who often used his talents to raise awareness during times of political peril. Keith Haring's work grew out of pop and street art and used bold color and simplified figures to bring attention to the fight for civil rights and the search for the AIDS cure. Other artists elevate absent voices. During the Harlem Renaissance of the 1920s, there was a cultural explosion of African-American artists, writers, photographers, and musicians producing powerful work independent of the mainstream artistic institutions that excluded them. The influence of this movement could still be seen today. Dorothea Lange's iconic photography documented the struggles of Dust Bowl refugees, immigrant farm laborers, and the poor living in rural South and city slums. Her photos portray the strength and fragility found in all people. Emmerich Kennard, an alumni of the Illustration Program, uses his tremendous drawing and design skills to create this image of hope. Illustration is effective, especially because it can be shared and distributed widely. Artist Carrie James Marshall depicts Black life, a subject that has been largely ignored or marginalized by the mainstream. His pieces layer specific details with abstract and graphic elements, making them timeless and more open to personal interpretation. Jeanne Maman was an illustrator and painter who grew up in Paris and later moved to Berlin in the 1920s to find work. She was a fashion illustrator and a painter, and most of her subjects were women and included haughty socialites, fashionable middle-class shop girls, street singers, and prostitutes. Many of her subjects were lesbian, some taking on alternative expressions of gender identity. Her work was called decadent, radical, and dangerous. Kehinde Wiley takes on the tradition of portraiture by using the use of compositions, symbols, and motifs, and rendering style of European masters to immortalize his black subjects. His work is a kind of subversive empowerment. He disrupts the viewer's unthinking acceptance of white privilege. Even in our darkest days, human nature seeks humor as a release. At the beginning of the US involvement in World War II, illustrator and magazine editor Ray Irvin depicted Adolf Hitler as a witch on a broomstick. Searchlights were commonly used to spot enemy bombers flying over major cities. We can also see a sad product of fear. The pumpkins in the left binding strip are an ugly, stereotypic depiction of the Japanese emperor. While this image was created by illustration alumni Shaheen Beardsley pre-pandemic, it nevertheless is a funny representation of the life of a sequestered artist. Remember, humor can be found in the everyday. And lastly, I'd like us all to remember to reimagine the future and to make images that express hope. Like this image done by alumni Sam Rodriguez. I know it might not feel like it, but unlike some graduates, you can do this thing that you love, this thing that you've been trained for, now, at this moment. The jobs may have to wait, and they will come if you do the good work. But when we can't be near each other, when we can't be out in the world, what we can do is communicate from one human to another. You can choose to respond directly to the current state of the world or indirectly, but know that your art emerges from your time and your experience. Get angry. Be compassionate. Make us laugh, distract us, remind us that life goes on, because we need that too. We need it all. I can't think of a finer group of young people to do this hard work. You're talented, you're sensitive, you're funny as hell. You're surprisingly optimistic. From all of the faculty, you make us so proud. Now go out in the world and make your mark upon it. Thank you. I'd now like to invite Michael Wertz to speak, Assistant Chair.
I'll keep this short, although there's a little bit of speechifying that's about to happen. What graduation is complete without some speechifying, so I'm gonna do some speechifying for you. First off, I miss everybody a lot. I hope you and your families are doing okay. I was lucky enough to work with some of you over the past few years. I saw some of the outstanding work coming out of portfolio and thesis this semester. I'm amazed at the depth and variety of the work. I am so proud of everybody here, all the work you've done to get here right now. I have two words for you to consider. The first word is nimble. Here's what you already know. Illustration is a flying carpet. Here's just a sample of the buffet. Hand skills, materials, traditional and digital, print design, production, concept, motion graphics, pattern, line, shape, plane, value, hue, shading, screen print, risograph, hand lettering, product design, public art, and personal publication. I know I'm missing something. Go ahead and drop it in chat. You're now expert collaborators, all of you. We've asked you to work in teams and to respond to difficult and arcane subjects. You've done the research and filled your sketchbooks with 30,000 ideas. Don't throw those away. They'll come in handy, I promise. You joined in hours-long crits and defended your work from flaming arrows. Your shields may be charred, but they are intact. You have the language you need to introduce yourself and your work to the world. Murals. Thanks, Eric. In addition, you each have a story to tell and the ability to tell that story with grace and compassion. Each of you looks carefully and sees under the surface of things to tell their story in a unique way. So here's the word, the word you'll need to make the carpet fly. The word is persistence. This is word number two. When I graduated, so just a little bit of personal history, when I graduated from CCAC in 1995, I had no earthly idea what I was going to do with my illustration degree. I had a piece of paper, a vague idea about what the publishing world was about, and a tackle box filled with number two pencils. I had a portfolio filled with pastel drawings inspired by my mentors, Vivian Flesher and Ward Shoemaker. They drew me a map of New York City and drew skulls and crossbones over the parts of town they wanted me to avoid. I went and fell in love with New York City. I was surprised to find a few people there who liked my work enough to hire me. Almost done, I promise. Slowly, slowly, I built a body of professional work. I discovered screen print and local indie shops and comic stores and the happy mutants who worked there. I showed up. I met as many people as I could and stayed in close touch with my fellow CCAC design graduates, some of whom were giving me jobs and gallery shows. Bolstered by a community of well-wishing, fiercely independent creators in San Francisco, I started to make a name for myself. In 2001, the world fell apart entirely. The Center of Publishing in New York exploded. Everyone I knew lost work, lost contracts, lost long-term clients. There was nothing to do but go inward. I retreated to the corner of the bedroom and I called the studio and I stayed there. I made a new drawing every day for 100 days, then another 100 days, then another. The new work was full of flat color and had a queerish bent. I made the work I wanted to make. I made work with friends because I wanted to, because nothing else seemed to matter. I wanted to make work that made people smile. Slowly, slowly, the work started to happen again. I started to get new jobs. Not the old work, though, the new work. The new work that I was showing that I was making with my friends. The new work was totally different from the old work, and I was actually having fun while I made pictures. My portfolio changed again and again. I made work that I was actually proud of, and I couldn't imagine stopping, even though there were months where I made very little money. I was persistent. I wanted to be an artist, so I kept making art. This month marks 25 years since I graduated from CCAC. I'm ready for another change, and the timing is exactly right. CCAC, CCA Illustrators. Let's check in with each other in 6 months, then again in 6 years, then again in 20 years. Make a schedule and stick to it. To all my new colleagues in this room right now, I can't wait to see what you come up with. I want to thank all of our speakers for being here this evening. Thank you to the CCA faculty who are also here. A lot of you showed up tonight who work just as hard on their teaching as they do on their craft. Thank you to the students and families and friends who are here tonight. Lastly, I want to send a heartfelt thank you to our program manager, James Yu, who is the epitome of grace under pressure. Thanks, everybody.
Okay, so Daniel Handler is best known as the writer of a series of unfortunate events published under the pseudonym Lemony Snicket. His wife, Lisa Brown, is an author, illustrator, and comic book artist, and distinguished faculty here at CCA. She's best known for such books as Vampire Boys Goodnight, and they're going to give us a special video presentation.
When are you going to turn it on?
It's on.
Oh, hi.
Hi.
Hello. Hi there. My name is Daniel Handler.
And I'm Lisa Brown.
And we are artists. I'm yes. a, what's the word for it, writer?
Yes.
And you, say what your thing is now.
I'm an illustrator.
Mm-hmm.
And a writer.
Yeah.
And a cartoonist.
Kind of three things.
Which is sort of the same thing as an illustrator.
Okay, so it's really just one thing.
I'm also a teacher.
That's true. Where do you teach?
I teach at the California College of the Arts.
Oh, a very familiar institution.
Yes.
We're speaking to graduates. Congratulations.
Congratulations.
We're very proud of you.
I'm proud of almost all of you.
Lisa Brown is proud of almost all of you, and I don't teach there, so I'm indiscriminate. I'm proud of all of you. All of you. Congratulations. This marks, you're graduating, so you're embarking on the life of an artist. That's exciting.
It's really exciting.
Of course, you're probably not thinking about that. You're probably thinking of life under a pandemic. That's what I'm thinking about.
I'm thinking about that constantly.
Yeah, it's hard. Constantly. I don't know if you guys follow the news at all, but we're in the middle of a global pandemic.
Yeah, there's some tough stuff going on.
Yeah, it's really hard. Luckily, however, there's some overlap in the Venn diagram between the life of an artist and life under a pandemic.
Right, so if you are learning how to live under a pandemic, then basically, you've learned how to be an artist.
I wonder if we could find out more through some kind of drawing of the Venn diagram. Hold on one second. Well, here it is. As you can see, there's quite a bit of overlap between the life of an artist and life under a pandemic. For instance, loneliness. I can't believe that anyone hearing this message, or anyone hearing anyone who has heard this message, has not experienced loneliness lately. A pandemic can make you lonely, and so can being an artist. Yeah, they look lonely. Also, frustration. Frustration is a huge part of being an artist and a huge part of living under a pandemic. Also, snacking. Snacking is a super important part of both. When you're completely isolated from the world, you want to enjoy some delicious snacks. Also, when you're struggling with the creative process, snacks help. Those look like maybe chips. I'm kind of an almond snacker. What are you, Lisa Brown?
Cookies.
Of course. Lisa Brown does love a cookie. Also, getting bad ideas. Bad ideas is a huge part of the artistic process. You have way more bad ideas than good ideas. And of course, when you're isolated in a pandemic, you're full of bad ideas and bad information. Also, solace in appreciating the work of others. Whether you're locked up and not allowed to leave your house, or whether you're frustrated with your own ineptitude and disappointment and failure as an artist, solace in the work of others is a major part of your day. Right, you might want to look at a gray rectangle that has a squiggle on it, or listen to some music such as Jimmy Smith, the jazz organist, whatever makes you feel a little better. Also, wearing whatever you want. A big part of being an artist is you get to wear whatever you want while you're making art, that is. Do you want to wear a smock? Do you want to wear wooden clogs and a wig? Do you want to wear a formal suit splattered with blood? Your own blood, I guess, or the blood of an ant? It doesn't matter. You can wear whatever you want. And same thing when you're trapped inside in isolation with your family or by yourself or with some hobos you've picked up on the street. You can wear whatever you want. Oh, that's nice. I like that. Also, a huge part of being an artist and a huge part of living under a pandemic is financial insecurity. Where's your next meal gonna come from? You can't always be sure. Financial insecurity. Also, staring at a screen for too long. Staring at a screen for too long. Who amongst us during this pandemic has not watched too many movies, too many press conferences, too many wacky YouTubes, too many Instagram live feeds? And of course, even if your art form does not involve staring at a screen normally, you will find yourself staring at a screen for too long. Whether you're explaining to a gallery owner via Zoom why you won't be able to turn in your beautiful paintings of pears, whether you're begging Hulu to accept your idea for a terrible sitcom, whatever it is, you'll spend too much time staring at screens. Which brings us to collaboration. Collaboration is a strong sense of comfort and adventure during a pandemic. And also during the artistic process. There's a collaborator there. Someone I collaborate with doesn't like to use the word collaborator because she says it reminds her of Nazi Germany. But that's not the kind of collaboration we mean. We mean the sharing of artistic ideas and the developing of some idea or a piece of art together. Yeah, I see that collaborator's also having a bad idea. Have to have a lot of bad ideas before you have a good one. How about a vague sense of hostility from the world? That's a big part of a pandemic in which the world feels like a hostile place. And then maybe also when you're an artist, you have a vague sense of hostility. It's not a pleasant feeling. And then my personal favorite, writing down ideas on a scrap of paper and then forgetting all about the scrap of paper and or spilling coffee on it. I've lost track of the number of times that I've had what I thought was a good idea and written it down on a scrap of paper, and then just off it goes into the world. The coffee is suspiciously gray, but we'll let it slide. It's weak coffee or maybe strong coffee?
Skim milk.
Skim milk. Damn you, skim milk, my old enemy. Which brings us to lots of coffee. A really important part of not only the creative process, but of life under a pandemic. You get tired, have some coffee. Feeling jittery, have a little coffee. Accidentally dunked your paints into your coffee by mistake, have some more coffee. The big mug looks the best to me. It's making me want coffee. Oh, I like that little round kind of pudgy mug too. Pudgy mug was my nickname in high school. And lastly, an overall feeling of doom. That's one of the most essential parts of being an artist, knowing that whatever tiny mark you're attempting to make on the world is ultimately futile, and that all of us have a huge well of shame and futility and disappointment and uselessness hovering around us, an overall feeling of doom. This is familiar to everyone nowadays, because there's nothing like a global pandemic to give you an overall feeling of doom. There's the rain of doom raining all over the CCA graduate and their fantastic ideas and their difficult artistic process and their coffee-stained, financially insecure, horribly ideated, clothing optional life. Well done, Lisa Brown.
Thank you.
Shall we go to our outro now?
We'll go to the outro.
Off to the outro.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Well, there you have it. Life as an artist and life under a pandemic. Congratulations to one. We hope it's a long lifetime journey. And boo to the other one. We hope it's over any minute.
Yeah. Cheers.
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 Don't you think we should turn it off? I think we should turn it off now. I think, turn it off. Fine. I want to drink this whole thing in one.
Good evening, CCA students. My name is George McCalman, and I am a designer and illustrator, just like you. I selected this spot to talk to you because I'm surrounded by nature. You will hear in the background birds chirping and sun. You'll see sun, and you'll hear the breeze behind you. And I thought it was appropriate to have that as a backdrop rather than the inside of my room, which is how so many of us have been viewing each other for the last few weeks. Greetings to you. Congratulations to you. This is a really momentous time in your lives. This is a really momentous time in our lives. And I wanted to say hello to you and congratulate you on the accomplishment of arriving at this point in your life. And I thought it's a really strange way that you all are getting to say goodbye to your college experience and embrace your new life experience. And so I'll start first by introducing myself. I am a career graphic designer. I graduated from the East Coast. I went to St. John's University. I graduated with a BFA in graphic design. I spent 20 plus years of my life in service to magazine design. I've spent a lot of time working with, collaborating with, being inspired by illustrators. A lot of my closest friends are illustrators and artists, and I always thought of myself as a facilitator and an encourager and a cheerleader of artistic talent. I opened up my own design studio 9 years ago. My studio's name is my last name, McCalman, and I slapped a CO after it, and so I became McCalman Co. A few years ago, after spending a number of years branding a number of companies that you've both heard of and have not heard of, I reached a really important point in my life where I started to question all of the things that I was doing, all of the things that were around me. I started questioning how I was moving through the world and who I was working with. And I decided to take a sabbatical 4 years ago, and I started illustrating and painting for the first time in 20 years since I'd graduated from college. My college experience was a really unique experience in that I, alongside graphic design, I practiced all of the applied fine arts. I sculpted, I painted, I drew. And I didn't know its importance in my life at the time. I didn't understand it at any other point. but I knew that I really wanted to do this. I wanted to embrace this craft, and I wanted to do it all the time. And so suddenly I became an illustrator, and my new life started as a fine artist and an illustrator 4 years ago. And I won't bore you with the things that I have done along the way, but what's important for this discussion and for you all is that I am now an illustrator. I have fully embraced that I am an illustrator. It's been a surprise to me to come to that conclusion. Being an illustrator has really opened up my eyes to the world. It has allowed me to really engage the world in a new way. I realize I'm paying more attention to a lot of things, that I'm telling stories that I used to collaborate with other people to do, and that now I do for myself. It's been a revelation to me. It's been a revelation to my life. It has changed the course of my life. And so when Michael and Owen asked me to speak to you in this really kind of strange way of recording a video and sharing it with you, I really had to think about what the importance of illustration has been in my life outside of what I've done. It's really about who I am and who you are as you're about to enter out into the world is even more than being an artist. You are a storyteller. You tell stories. And for those of you that are wondering out loud and internally, how am I going to be an illustrator during this time, during this year? You all are exiting out of your school life, really seemingly at a deficit. You know, the world seems to be in abject chaos, and a lot of the structures of order that we have had in place that school has provided for you seemingly are tenuous right now. And so how do you navigate that? How do you assign yourself value? How do you tell yourself that what you're doing right now is important? And I am not going to sugarcoat it. You all are in a really strange time. I'll just tell you how I have navigated this time, and maybe it'll provide some solace for you, and maybe it won't, but it is very much the truth of how I have spent the last couple of months during self-quarantine, making sense of what I do. When shelter-in-place first started, I went into I wouldn't say a spiral. I would say very much confused. I was really confused for a couple of weeks. What my worth was, what I was doing, if what I was doing had any importance. And I spent some time taking walks around the city on the days that I left my apartment. And one of the things I started paying really close attention to is nature and the natural world. Just at the point where we were all going inward, nature was in bloom. I started noticing how slowly nature moved, but how persistent it was. That flowers were in bloom, that the colors, I noticed textures, I noticed smells more concretely. And I started really sinking into what the natural world was telling me. And I started realizing that the lessons and the answers of what I was going to be during this time was really right in front of me. And I started realizing that I had more of an obligation to tell stories, to use my craft, to document the world around me, that it was really important, and it was more important than I had realized, that I had to continue doing what I was doing. And so I will pass on to you that I think it is your responsibility to continue doing what you were doing before all of this started, that it's really crucial to our evolution as human beings to have visual storytellers. It is a really important thing that the world needs, that the world requires. And as we're all realizing more how much we need each other, that it's not just a crisis to reiterate that, but that we should all be aware of it. I am challenging you all to really sink deeper into your own processes during this time, and to remind yourself of the importance of what you, of the gifts that you are giving to yourselves and to those around you during this time. Your lives are not going to be simple. It is not going to be straightforward, but it is going to be really crucial. And it took me 20 years to realize my gifts, that I had a responsibility to continue doing what I am put on earth to do, and that is to tell visual stories, to document the world that I see around me. And I think that that is your responsibility too. So to you I say, good luck. And not as a way of saying you're on your own, I'm saying good luck in your search for yourself, in your search for your craft. The wonderful thing about CCA is that you have a network, so you're not alone. And I hope you all know that, and I hope you take that out into the world with you. You have a network. You have people around you that are invested in your success. I had a lot of people around me that were invested in mine, and that's why I sit here comfortably in front of you, giving you the same advice that I got a number of years ago when I decided to step towards it. A really dear friend of mine said, "You don't have a choice." And so I'm saying to you, you don't have a choice. Continue doing what you are doing.
Our student speaker, Yuri Knighten. Yuri is an illustrator, a sculptor, and an avid reader. In their professional work, they strive to push the bounds of traditional illustration. From crayons to watercolor to the third dimension, a lifetime of narrative stands behind their work. In Yuri's personal practice, they explore themes of grief, depression, and how to move forward. They are originally from Washington State, which explains why water, waves, and rain are consistent subjects running through their visual catalog. In 2019, Yuri was the recipient of the Society of Illustrators John Clamer 3D Award. Please welcome to the Zoom, Yuri Knighten.
Yay! Hi everyone, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, my sister and her wonderful roommate are quarantined outside on the deck, and I can hear them screaming through the door. So that's really nice. Well, that was really, it's going to be difficult to follow up Lisa Brown and Pudgy Mug, but I'm going to do my best. No worries, it's a scant 2 pages. And like a millennial, classically, I'll be reading off my phone. All right. I'm starting this speech listening to Hilary Duff's Metamorphosis album and looking up what to say in a graduation speech. I slept wrong on my neck, so I have to turn my whole torso to look around, and no position is painless for long. Dismay is setting in, all the speech ideas are from very famous actors, and I just got rejected from the final round of casting for a TV show. After a while, I stopped reading and just vibed with Hillary. With my neck, I couldn't absolutely throw down, but you could compare it to quarantine. The burning desire to thump around a 700 square foot apartment to your elementary school anthem, but instead being an uncanny bench statue on the couch while your partner watches Peep Show. Butter the toast, eat the toast, shit the toast. God, life is relentless. Well said, Mark Corgan. As a person with clinical depression who isolates most of the time on my own, I don't know if I could say I miss life before because it wasn't that different. There's just no cap to anxiety now when I leave the house. I spoke at my high school graduation. It was extremely hopeful because it was before I had debt or knew my mom had cancer. But aside from that, I haven't really changed all that much. After all, here I am speaking again, walking into another disaster right out of graduation. It feels unfair because everything feels unfair when it affects you personally. This isn't unique though. Many graduating classes have exited school amidst a national collapse of public structure. I know this because the people who have called to check in on me are not only CCA professors, but have, if you can believe it, been through difficult times as well. I remember I used a quote from author and professor John Augustus Shedd in my high school graduation speech. A ship at harbor is safe, but that's not what ships are built for. My first ship from high school sailed into a storm of cancer, depression, loss, and my eventual graduation from CCA. Now I'm casting off into a different storm, but so is everyone else. It's too late to be concerned about how well you built your ship. Some of us may even have to learn how to swim. But even a deserted island has a beach, so we have to find it. I could say, this class is so resilient, but I don't know all of you. My high school class was 90 people, so I did know everyone, and I felt comfortable making generalized statements. Some of you may be falling apart. Some of you may be scared for your life. Some of you may think this is a hoax. If I can say anything about going through it, it's that time will pass anyway, and regardless of how you feel. You may not think of yourself as strong or admirable, but one day you wake up on the other side of this. So maybe you are strong and admirable after all. I toyed with writing a stand-up comedy routine, but decided against it because I think everyone feels weird enough robo-attending a graduation while someone on the call is most definitely not wearing pants. Also, it would be cruel a trick on Michael and Owen who let me write whatever I wanted. I feel like somehow the stand-up routine would have been more memorable than any send-off I could make, though. I don't think it matters that you won't remember what I say. I do think it matters that we remember how lucky we were to be part of this program. Those of you who know me know that I take issues with the college as a whole. So when I say I came back after a two-year leave because of the illustration department was worth it, I really mean that. I'm always between the desire to keep my side of the street clean and trying to forgive myself for my own mistakes. Right now, when I feel so helpless, I have one foot in each. It's really easy to feel like we're not doing enough, and it's easy for me to say that as someone with resources and support from my family. Here are things that have really helped me to hear. You're doing fine. You are good at what you do. You can only do what you can do. And it's okay if things aren't normal right now. Much like a bidet, art as an everyday experience is seen as too luxurious. But right now, when there's a limit on toilet paper and quarantine has monotonized the daily routine, everyone wants good art and a bidet. We're storytellers. Everyone's brain is cycling and recycling their own thoughts and ideas, so we can step into that space and give people something new. Visual narrative work takes people out of their lives and puts them into a different space. Despite being one of the first groups to fall under non-essential, basically every school has a history on art and art course, and millions of people dedicate their lives to it. Art persists and records human experience. We've all been studying how to do this for a couple years, and now it's time to put it into practice. With nothing but time on our hands, we can look inward. Now's the time to make whatever you feel because everyone's watching. Everyone wants to see something new because they've been staring at the same stuff for 16 hours a day. It's time to use our art practice for advocacy and allyship. And we don't need to look any further than the Bay for inspiration in artists like Emory Douglas, whose work became the voice of resistance and justice with the Black Panthers. A picture is supposedly worth 1,000 words, which is good because I've seen some rough essays during my time at CCA. But with those images, say 1,000 words, say 10,000 words, because you can. And be kind to yourselves, be kind to your family, be kind to your goals. So let's all drink, I have sparkling water, to getting our degrees despite the shifting ground. We did it, and even though I don't know all of you, I'm very proud to be part of this graduating class. Thank you guys. And thank you to Michael and Owen. And all the professors that are here. They're pounding banging on the door now. I'm going to mute it.
That was awesome. Thank you, Yuri. Our next speaker is Minnie Phan. Minnie Phan is an illustrator and cartoonist based in Oakland, California. Minnie is an enthusiast and jumped into the life of the illustrator headfirst after graduating from CCA. She focuses on themes of cultural diversity, personal stories, and the invisible things that shape who we are. She has worked with Google, Starbucks, NPR, Airbnb, Abrams Books, The Progressive, the list goes on. When she isn't illustrating, she teaches comics to youth in the Bay Area and advocates for safer streets for bicyclists. Please welcome to the Zoom, Minnie Phan.
Wow, that was an awesome introduction. I'm ready for this. okay. Well, first, thank you so much to CCA, to Michael, to Owen, to Robert for inviting me to this experience. It's pretty damn special. It's amazing. You know, this is a very stressful time, but I feel so honored to help you through and to inspire each other. So let's get into this. Okay. So good evening and congratulations. Seriously, you did it. You survived countless all-nighters, hours of critique, and roller coaster waves of anxiety and depression. I went to art school. I know how stressful it is. I know how hard it is. I'll never let anyone tell you you went to an easy school. You didn't. Second, you should be so proud of yourself and your accomplishments. Really, take this moment, take it in, and just be so proud of yourself. Now, you may be wondering who I am. You're like, who is this person? Why is she talking to me? Well, I will admit, I'm not yet a world-renowned illustrator or a best-selling author. And I am what I feel is at the beginning of my career. But I have been through the darkest of times and came through brighter, energized, and more passionate. I'm here because I've been where you are, and you're gonna be where I am. I so believe that. It's so true. So my story may not be much different from yours. To begin, I was born in Stockton, California to refugee parents from Vietnam. My parents have a fifth grade and a third grade education, and they raised five kids in America without knowing English. So I grew up between two worlds. I suffered through high school and I found my calling through art. I think many of you can relate to that last part, finding your calling through art. And when I discovered the power of art, I decided to go to art school, and I went with my parents' complete disapproval. I think I broke their hearts every year I didn't drop out, and they broke mine as I pulled all-nighters and went through school without their support. And to get by, I worked nine different part-time jobs at CCA before I graduated in 2014. I wanted it. I wanted to be an artist. I wanted to work hard, and I wanted to make my dreams come true. But I graduated broke and scared and depressed. That's the truth. At one point, I had suicidal ideation and wanted to give up. But I kept going. I needed to make art and I needed to tell my story. So I didn't give up. In the 6 years since I graduated, as Michael noted, I worked for Google and Starbucks, Airbnb, and these other clients. I've illustrated 10 music posters for the Fillmore, so I haven't paid for a concert in a long time. And I signed with a children's book agency. I've exhibited in galleries across the U.S. I even once met a deadline while traveling through rural Japan. That was crazy. I actually got a call from a client the day I was packing my bags to leave for a month. And I was like, okay, I'll take the job. And so I was doing sketches in the Beijing airport, shipping things in Japan. It was awesome. But anyway, so I am proof. I am proof that what you dream, you can have it, and you're going to get there. You're going to get to where you want to be. But it will require a lot of work and a few key ingredients, which I'm going to share. I'm going to share my famous recipe with you. So listen up. Get your ears ready. Okay, so first, this is very important. Take care of yourself. Catch up on sleep. Keep a healthy schedule. Healthy. And learn to love yourself. Be your number one cheerleader. Not only believe in yourself, invest in yourself. Take care of your mental health. And if you can't afford a therapist, I know it seems so scary, but if you can't afford a therapist, remember art can, has, and will save your life. So keep making art no matter who is watching, no matter who it's for. Make art even if you're broke. Make art even if you're doing just fine. Just keep making. The hunger to make will be your fuel when things are aimless or slow, like right now. So keep making art. Second to my recipe, value community. You and those around you will shape the future. Turning the page now. Beyond business and beyond networking, a good community will remind you of what you love to do and why you do it. It's true. When you see someone doing cool stuff, you're like, oh man, that's awesome. I want to do that too. So a great community will also nourish you when you feel like giving up and inspire you to keep going. Community is what will help you stay focused. Most people, this is going to be hard to hear. You may not understand this, CCA. Most people are never going to understand what being an illustrator or an artist is, but your creative friends will. Your colleagues will. So keep them close and see your peers not as competition, but as colleagues. Moreover, remember there are no mistakes. There is not a single mistake that you can make because there is no such thing as perfection. Never compare yourself because comparison is the enemy of joy. It sounds so cliche, but it's true. You know, it never helps. In the coming years, you will experience success and setbacks, slow beginnings, and exciting opportunities. At times, you're going to scroll through Instagram or Facebook or whatever future platform there's going to be, and you're going to see someone doing something so dang cool. And you're going to say, why aren't I there yet? Why can't I do that? Why didn't I make the right choices? You're going to see someone else and think they have it better than I do. And let me tell you right now, that there is no shame in making a path that is all yours, your own unique path. Some classmates are going to jump into tech, others will become parents, and many will work a part-time job to get by. Some of your paths will take 1 year, others 5 or 10. After graduating, I actually dip my toes into a bit of everything. At different times, I've worked in retail, at an office, as a teacher, at a startup, in fashion, all while being a freelance illustrator. It's just the reality, but it was my path. For me, those were necessary steps, necessary stepping stones to make my dreams come true and then made my dreams more clear. I didn't let myself get stuck in any of those dead-end jobs. I never lost sight of my dreams, never. I didn't become complacent. And I made it work. Every time I clocked into my day job, get all dressed up and cute when I clock in, I would have a vision. I have a vision for what I want to accomplish in my studio. I prioritized my work and I moonlighted when I had to. I made work that brought me joy and I trusted that it would do the same for others. So trust me when I say this, life only gets better. It only gets better. You will find your way and your own version of success. Your own version. I mean, that's pretty damn cool. Your own version of success. All right, finally, this is probably the secret ingredient to the recipe, so make sure you stock up on this one, okay? Finally, what matters more than talent is resilience. Let me say that again. What matters more than talent is resilience. In the past, I misunderstood my parents' disapproval as a lack of love. But now I see their true gift was being my first example of resilience. Resilience is what helps you start over in a new country. Resilience is what pulls you through the darkest days. Resilience is what you and we as a collective have during immensely challenging times. So take this degree and run. Run, run towards your dreams, run towards uncertainty, and embrace what scares you most. You will surprise yourself. So thank you, and go, and congratulations, and you got this. And I wish you all the best, and please stay in touch, tell me what you're doing. You got this. Congratulations again.
Hey, Minnie. Fantastic. If this were a real regular graduation, this is a real graduation. If this were a normal graduation, we would be on the stage and you'd be walking across. We get to look at some art tonight, which is not something that happens every time. So we're going to enjoy it. I will let Michael do the honors because I tend to get tongue-tied, as you guys have all seen. But let's get started with the roll call. And let's look at some amazing artwork from these grads. So we'd like to present the class of 2020, candidates for the Bachelor of Fine Arts degree in illustration from California College of the Arts. Michael, take it away.
Aaron Awe. Zara Avoyan. LaStarla Barker. Miguel Barajas.
Yes! Miguel!
Please forgive me if I mispronounce your names. Sabine Bolovsky.
Hey, Sabine.
Lydia Bielkowski. Timothy Brumley.
Yeah, Tim!
Yeah.
Iris Chang.
Iris!
Come on, high distinction.
Come on, high distinction.
Eric. Chippa-Mariwo.
Right. Benjamin Conway.
Very nice.
Benjamin, yes.
Lucas Kranz.
Yes.
Taeyun Chen. Esther Aaliyah.
Esty!
Journey Giulietti.
Yes! Yes, Journey!
Frankie Gutierrez.
Well, but I have the art.
Simone Hanon.
Yes, Simone! High distinction.
Kartik Yango.
Yes, Kartik.
Yeah.
Emma Jenkins. Gina Kadura. Yes.
Yeah, Gina.
Lean Cogier.
Oh, yeah, Lean.
Yuri Knighten.
Yeah.
Lloyd Kwok.
Lloyd.
Coco Lee. Karen Simone Lee. Melissa Richie. Vanessa Lim. Constantine Luo.
Hey, Constantine.
Nicole Liu.
Hey, Nicole.
Yes. Brittany Mack. Elizabeth McConaughey Oliver.
Yep. Yes.
Joe Mitchell.
White chocolate. Yeah. So they, on the table in the candy dish.
Whoa. Julie Nigeri. Young Park. Woo! David Reyes. Enzo Segovia.
Enzo!
Gunshin.
Wow.
Stephanie Sassara Silva.
Stephanie.
She's got nipples.
Audrey Song.
Yeah.
Woo!
Sabrina Spencer.
Nice. Thank you.
Callie Stratton. Yeah.
Karina Soufflé.
Jane True. Yuzhu Wang.
Yo, Harry.
Wah, yay.
Harry.
Xiting Zhang.
Very nice.
Interesting.
Kat Zembrowska.
Yeah.
Lucy Zhu.
Lucy!
No!
Oh!
Over!
Only that painting.
Oh! Yeah! We did it, guys!
We did it!
Three, two, one. Congratulations!
Congratulations! We're gonna miss you. We're gonna miss all of you, and we hope you come back and stay in touch with us, and we hope to see you in real life as well as in a virtual way. But we honor you all. We're really proud of you, and you're going on a huge adventure. You're pioneers in a new world, and we love you.
I see Therina here, and Mark, Shannon, Kim, Josh is here, and Isabella's here. There's a few more CCA faculty. I'm kind of putting you on the spot. But if anyone,
may I chime in?
Of course, please, Mark.
I just want to say what a joy it is to see all these smiling faces. So many of the people that are graduating this year, I had to work with you all. And I want to reiterate what so many of the speakers have said. We have absolute faith in all of you to make your mark on the world, and do stay in touch, because you are the greatest. All of you work very hard, very proud to have worked with you. And to we love you, as I said. So you're part of the family now. Stay in touch.
Please
stay in touch.
Thanks, Mark!
Enzo!
Enzo, yeah.
I just want to say congratulations to you all. Your work is, I saw some of you in materials class a long time ago, it seems, and you've become these wonderful, competent, just really impressive artists, and I have so much love for you going forward, and you're always welcome in any of my classes to come back, and I'm so, so proud.
We love you, Shannon.
I see Roman's here too. Roman's here. Roman. Isabel, a few other folks.
With a big lip.
So, anybody else? Any other CCA faculty want to chime in? Bob's here. Before I forget, I should show you all this. You're getting one of these in the mail. Hold on, let me turn this off.
Special certificate.
Let me turn this off. Okay, you're all getting one of these in the mail. This is your diploma that the faculty has put together for you. Everyone's getting your, of course you're getting a CCA diploma as well, but this is a little something special we made for each of you.
Michael, do you want to read it?
Oh, it says ad astra per aspera. Ad ventus fortunque vivat. From the stars to the stars.
It's
like one of Eric's uncles.
I'll read the rest of it. To all persons to whom this writing may come, greetings. On the 16th day of May, 2020, be it known that we, in recognition of the successful completion of the requisite course of study, and by virtue of authority granted us due you, as a colleague in the Distinguished League of CCA Illustrators, and it's signed by it was written the calligraphy is by Bob, and then we signed it as well.
Aww.
Congratulations, everybody! Aww. So proud of you,
Michael.
All right. So go ahead. Let's have one more giant round of applause and yell for the class of 2020.
Congratulations!
Congratulations!
Congratulations, everybody.
Congratulations, everyone.
Love you guys so much.
We can hang out here for a little bit. I'm not going to turn the camera off yet, but the party will start, the after party. You're all invited. Just stay in this room. I might turn my camera off for a bit to stay in this room, and we'll come back in an hour, and we'll have a special DJ set by DJ AARP.
Get to see our teachers dancing.
Yeah. Embarrassing. Be prepared to be embarrassed.
Are we recording that as a Zoom?
I'm going to stop recording. Congratulations, everybody. So proud of you.
Thanks to all the parents.
Thank you to the parents. Thanks to the
families for coming.
Thank you. Thanks, Robert. Cheers.
Yes.
I'll see you back here in an hour. About 45 minutes. We'll see you back here at 9.
So proud of you.
Go, David.
Bye. Love you, Elizabeth.
See you at 9 o'clock.
See everybody at 9.
Yes.
Yes.
Love you.
It's a lot.
Oh my God, that's so high now.
Congratulations.